to all. Let the other guys get the coffee. To start with, my name is Venkateswaran. Do refer as Venkat. Along with me, my colleague Anil.
Hi.
We are going to walk through the journey of agile transformation done in Cisco video business. So predominantly, to start with, as I said, it's me. Around 14 plus years of experience I have in embedded domain, working for various areas of product development and customer delivery projects in domains like consumer electronics, mobile multimedia, and digital broadcasting. On top of that, 4+ years of agile experience I have in transforming the organization within Cisco, as well as executing research-based projects, product development, and customer projects.
Hi, I'm Anil, senior product manager at Cisco. I have about 17 years of experience in the digital TV domain, mostly focused around project management, project delivery, pre-sales, and currently part of the product management team in Cisco Video Client Solutions, focused on the software side of the set-top box solutions. Back to you.
Yeah, so the moment when we say Cisco, people do connect with routers or networking systems, but this Cisco is related to pay TV. I was part of NDS 3 years before, so Cisco has acquired NDS. We were into pay TV business. So we were predominantly into cable, digital broadcast, satellite, mobile, and internet. So these are the kind of end-to-end solutions we give to our end customers who are nothing but operators. And this is the kind of product portfolio we have. We have standard definition Zapper setup box, high definition, HD PVR, IP box, video everywhere. So these are the kind of product solutions we do deliver to our customers. As of now, we have been engaged with, or the partners who are engaged with us is around 47 plus pay TV operators worldwide, and we have around 78 plus million subscriber base. And these are some of the few customers who are been working with us. So in this journey, why Agile for our Cisco video business? So if you see in the TV pay TV space, or even video viewing space, there is a lot of changes been happening from last one decade. And there is a lot of changes are happening in marketplace, which are pretty much fast. And we need to catch up with that to sustain our business model and to ensure the existing customer base and to get the same revenues. And then for the employees to focus and to have fun at work, like as Z just bought the joy part, we just wanted to be ensuring that. And then we want to improve the predictability of launching the complex features. Like earlier, we used to have a new feature which we want for 6 months. We used to take for deploying it to launch it 1.5 years. So we want time to market also to improve. So I'm going to cover this journey into 3 stages. One is with the preparation, whatever we did, and how did we kick off, and how are we maturing right now. So basically, we have 3 levels of transformation categories we did. One is on the organization level, second one is on the execution level, and on the people level. So predominantly from the organization and execution level, my colleague Anil will speak about it, and on the people level, I will speak about it. Yeah, Anil.
Didn't expect to have 2 things in my hand.
I'll do that.
Okay, a lot of, I realized I was sitting in Dhananjay's presentation, a lot of, you would see a lot of commonality in the issues, the issues and the challenges we try to resolve in our journey. So before I take you on the journey, I just give a bit of a history in that from our NDS and into the Cisco days, we did have some form of Agile pre-2014, localized some teams picking up Agile methodologies, trying to implement it and see how it works with them. We had some local success. We had some failures. And around early 2014, end of 2013, the senior leadership of our group had an opportunity to take the whole group, around 550 people, through a full agile transformation, backed on the Cisco Escape Velocity program. So this was a Cisco-wide program which encouraged the engineering organization to adopt agile. So as part of that, the leadership team decided to take the whole team, the whole organization, into the transformation, agile transformation. And I think one of the key decision points is your leadership signing up for this, and they deciding that they have a business need to make this transformation. And then you come to the problem of the structural situation that you have, the org structure that you have, and having to move it from a traditional system that you're working with to a pro-agile structure that would help you on your journey. So, okay, we were a component, we were organized component-based. The expertise were built in components, and the team was built around components. We had multiple components, we were a layered architecture, and we built up the reporting structure in such a way that it matched the components that we had in the architecture. And to supplement that, we had a metrics organization which had a set of project managers and an integration and validation team which would then support this team into taking whatever code was done by the component team, integrate it and deliver it to the customer. So this is the organization structure we had. And from here, we had to move to a pro-agile thing. We had to go to cross-functional teams and move from the component-based structure to a end-to-end cross-functional feature teams. And this is where we ended up. So we had Scrum teams which report into directors that report into the general manager, and in the support, we had the product, the other roles, the product owners, Scrum Masters, strategists, and the product managers. You had the coaches also as an integral part of our organization. So this was the organization level change. The second one was to have an execution model change. So I just told you about how our architecture was organized, and you would see that from the system architecture, each component derived their design, did their coding, did their release as a piece of code, as a component piece of code, and then it was delivered. So this is a very waterfall model with parallel component development happening, and then you have an integration team which is specialized to a particular customer, which would do the big bang integration of all that is required for that, all the development that has been done by the component teams for that particular customer, integrated, fixed all the issues that you find in the component level integration, and then delivered into the product. Now, if you scale this, you would see that for the second project or the second customer, you would have another team, and another integration team, which would do a similar work of taking all the component development and then integrating it and delivering it to the product. So you had a problem of the scaling of your integration teams to deliver to customer, and it had to pass through that big bang integration, the waterfall model, and then the big bang integration before reaching the product. So there was a lot of time spent in delivering it to the product. So the pro-agile execution model that we came up, which is you have Scrum teams that work on the same projects now, customer projects. They do their design, development, and integration, and deliver directly into the product, right? So we have eliminated the need of that integration team that we had in between. So a similar, the scaling of it, you had for the second project, another set of Scrum teams delivering their changes directly into product. And this point that we had quicker deliveries to the product and more deliveries to the product on a frequent basis. Now, in this journey, in the execution model transformation, we did see one interesting problem in that when we were in the component structure, the expertise was very local. And you had component experts who helped in the design and then helped in the review, right? Once you move to cross-functional Scrum teams where you had people from across components, you suddenly had to fill in this gap because you were now cross-functional and across components, right? So we sort of encouraged people to become moderators, and they are the gatekeepers of our code architecture. So the primary aim of having the integrators is to keep the sanctity of our main trunk. They are the gatekeepers of the architecture. Each team builds or contributes to the moderators and have sufficient moderators so that whatever they check in does not break the code and the main trunk. And we have encouraged these moderators to transform from being local experts to being vertical, cross-functional moderators. Okay. Yeah. Back to you.
So now comes on the people part. So when we are having the traditional waterfall, so we have roles like project manager, program manager, component lead, team lead. So when we want to move these roles to pro-agile roles, where we have product owner, scrum master, and individual contributor, or a scrum team member. So that is where we had to go through a challenge, like how should we do that? Then that is where the senior management has taken the people part also seriously, where the individual preferences are being asked, vis-a-vis like what are the business priorities we have, and based on that there was a room given for an individual to say that, you know, I want to become a PO maybe, and then see for 6 sprints, and if it doesn't fit, so he will be given a second chance to, you know, take other role. So that kind of a room was given. And then we moved from the fancy designation kind of a you know, hierarchy to a profession-based roles. That means when you're opting for as a PO or a Scrum Master, you are really thinking as a profession, not like you know, the project manager, senior project manager. Instead of that, you try to contribute to that role more efficiently and effectively. Like as a Scrum Master, you start with one team, then be a Scrum Master for 2 teams, then, you know, you scale up as a Scrum Master. So for any organization, like as we discussed in the morning, few sessions here about the culture and values. So definitely every organization comes with a culture which has good and bad, whether you are following waterfall or whether you are following agile. So now when you are trying to take this transformation, you just review what are the good parts of your culture you have as an organization, what are the strengths, and what are the things you want as an organization to unlearn. So based on that, you decide and you know, frame a values. So this is how like the senior management and the teams together signed off on a values. This is what the way forward on these values we live with whenever we have any dilemma on, you know, doing these things or that things. So let's see this value as a sounding board, make it visible across, and try to navigate you know, our decision making based on these values, so that then only it will mature our practices or ceremonies, whatever we are following on, that which can sustain over the time. So keeping that values in mind, when we started, this is where we said that the senior management team, say for example, vice president, director, whoever are the key elements of that BU are the ones who are going to take the leadership training first, so that they work in the form of a scrum, so that they can lead by example. So they had a 5-day rigorous training, they formed as a scrum team, they created the transformation backlog. How should we, you know, way forward do the transformation for around, you know, 550 people? How about it? They created the backlog items, they created the storyboard, they have a scrum board. So they had led with example, and then they hired external coaches who can able to guide them so that if there are any behavioral changes or with about practicing the ceremonies, they are of great help. And this is where the outcome of that backlog was translated into 7 batches, where we have around 60 to 70 people, you know, from spread across to 4 or 5 backlogs of whether it is a feature backlog, product backlog, or a project backlog. And then a primary coach has been identified for each backlog who can able to handhold them and guide them for the first 6 sprints. So we had to start with, we had 2 external coaches and 2 internal coaches to start with. And this is the, you know, a kind of a steps we take. Once the batches are identified, backlogs are identified, this is the circle they go through. Like within that, each backlog, we identify the leadership team. For them, we identify it, and then we have a 3-day training for them so that they understand what are the ceremonies, what is Agile is all about, what is Agile Manifesto, and what is the obstacle, what is the definition of done. So these things were being taught in the training, and then they create a leadership backlog for the backlog, whether it is a customer project or a feature project or you know, or a product. So they create that. Then you have the team training for 3 days, and then they execute a mini sprint so that they understand what is the prioritization, how the planning is done, how the retrospectives are done, how the daily stand-up is being performed. So that in the 1 week mini sprint, we do that. And then a hand-holding for the team by the coaches will be there for the next 6 weeks. So in that process, what happens is people first understand on the process part so that they all get aligned, and the work creating working agreements. So people slowly start moving into that agile mindset. And then after that, whenever the support is needed, we do that. As our business actually is a little bit complicated, as I said, we are into PTV. We have an end-to-end deployment. Say, for example, satellite, uplink, downlink. You have a head-end and you have a box at different subscriber base. When we are releasing an image, there is a margin of error should be very low. So in that case, the competencies may not be located at one site. It could be located at across multiple sites, which are distributed scrum teams. So when you are starting this journey, the key important thing is we need to get along with all of them, including delivery, account, sales, you know, end-to-end architect, everybody together in this journey to make it success. With that kickstart, how are we in the maturing process? As we are dealing with a product which is having legacy, on top of that, which has been matured in the field from last 10 years, on top of that, we are creating new features. The biggest thing we have is like technical depth. For any organization to mature and practice agile and move faster, we need to assess the technical depth. The kind of technical depth we had is with respect to automation, CA infrastructure. There are many ways, many technical depth, like testing, from manual testing, you want to move to automation testing, or your build is taking like 10 hours. So these are all things which maybe exist, and you need to see, are these a depth which you can able to clear in a day, or it is going to be long term. Then you need to strategize that to make faster the teams to move faster and close the stories. So some of the things what we did was we created a working agreement, then we created a definition of done with buy-in of the scrum teams, where they said, if I am writing a one line of a code, introducing it, these are the things I adhere to and I follow. Then the second thing is, like, if the technical depths are little very like monster kind of a thing, to handle that, we set technical depth reduction day, and we set a theme for each backlog. Somebody might have a technical depth of automation. Somebody might have a technical depth of you know, building the build infrastructure. So these things, all hands, you know, one day, so that they can contribute and reduce the depth whatever we have. And also like effective engineering practices. Apart from that, another flow is about obstacles. So this is something people do refer, and the hardest part of any obstacle is like to realize that. Like, what is the obstacle which is slowing down the team or in that backlog? If we realize it, I think the 50% of the problem is solved. So for this, what we did was we had a kind of a visibility workflow where we said the scrum teams, when they are trying to do the daily stand-up, they say, based on the task breakup, you know, I cannot able to move the task forward. Is there any obstacle? It could be anything. Like, obstacle can start with a server room adjacent sitting to a developer is making noise, and I am not able to work properly. Starting with that, your build is taking like longer times. your CI infrastructure is not robust. I don't have the APIs to be developed, or I don't have the reviewer available on time. So it could start with from very small things which can slow down to any major systemic obstacles your organization have. The key workflow is bring this, surface it out first, and bring it visible to the organization within the team and outside the team, so that whoever has the competency to act and resolve it faster, this workflow has helped us a lot. So we have a promotion criteria also in this is like after 48 hours, if the team cannot able to resolve that obstacle, we promote it to the program board. So we bring that visibility to the program level. Within 48 hours we don't get that, we bring it to the exec level. So that we wanted to bring that highest attention that if this obstacle is not resolved, we cannot able to close this story or this release has an impact. So that we play a kind of a key role, and here Scrum Master is the one who actually plays a key role in identifying, nailing it, solving it, and tracking it. So some of the systemic obstacles what we have encountered in our journey so far is like poor build CI infrastructure, poor automation infrastructure, shortage of competencies, inflexible software architecture. So what are the ways we have dealt so far is like the poor build infrastructure, like we had a CI earlier, which used to run for 24 hours. But the point is the reliability and the robustness of that was challenged. And then we took an action item on that obstacle, and then the resolution was we invested in the infrastructure, we increased the number of build servers we need, and also the frequency of the feedback, so that a developer, when he check-ins, he knows that he has made a foul or is it good. So that 4 hours, 12 hours, so that there is a constant feedback which gives to the developer in a day at least twice or thrice. Then the poor automation infrastructure, like we had a huge number of manual test cases which we need to run to ensure that there is no regression for the code what we are going to deliver to customer, but the time taken to complete that manual testing was huge. And if we want to really get an instant feedback for the only automation is the only way out. And for us to build that automation infrastructure from scratch, it is a huge obstacle. That is what we also identify as a technical debt. The resolution what we found was at least once in a month, like one day in a month, let all the workforce within our BU put hands on different features, whatever we have, and build the at least 5 scripts in that day, for different features, so that we can able to build an infrastructure which is reliable and which can be used interdependently. And the other thing was shortage of competence. Yes. Yeah. No, here.
I think Jeff wants me to repeat your question. You are saying that we are spending one day in a month resolving the automation problems.
No. That is not
what Venkat said is that we are running the tech reduction day, the technical debt reduction day, once a month, and the concentration for that day is on getting your legacy automation covered. So you do about 5 or 10 scripts, depending on what the team are willing to commit for that particular day. You try to reduce your technical debt.
2 weeks. Yeah. And it is for the all backlogs. That is what as an organization we have concluded that 2 weeks is the duration. And then shortage of competencies, as the moment when we moved from the competencies within the pockets to a cross-functional team, we cannot scale up, those many competencies can be available in each backlog. So we definitely have a shortage. So the only way what we did was we invested in a technical coach and tried to see at least if we have a backlog and we need C skills, okay, at least 5 people. Java skills, we need 10 people. Automation skills, we need 3 people. Like that, at least whatever the minimum can be provided, we accommodate, and then we see in next 6 months, by doing pair programming or test-driven development or extreme programming, how can we able to scale up? So that we are seeing some results, like some people are doesn't want, like a tester sometimes is interested to become a developer, sometimes a tester want to be a tester only. So we take that individual preferences into account and we see how we can able to scale up. And inflexible software architecture, this is where we have a goal that where we were releasing earlier like yearly once a launch From there, we moved to 2 months a launch. From there, we want to move to 2 weeks. And from there, we want to move for 1 day. Like each day, can you able to give a potential shippable increment software which can able to be there. So for that, if our current architecture, code architecture doesn't support, then we have to move to a modular architecture which can enable us. So these are the things we have encountered, and this is the way how we have dealt with that. To sustain our way forward, actually, we need to create sufficient. Like external coaches were there, they handled us. But then we started creating like internal, we have two tracks. One is on the process track, and another one is on the technical track. We start created like internal champions who can able to, like next batches whoever are coming, they can able to join with them and try to see how they can able to share their knowledge and learn from them, and we can improve together. And our journey continues. So with this, actually, I want to just share a quick highlight on the what are the unique things actually we think in our Agile transformation we had got or we wanted to share with you all is Cisco has, as Anil mentioned, like Cisco has a escape velocity. We call it as a playbook, which is a kind of a framework, which is the start. Like when a BU says, I want to move to Agile for my business reasons, where should I start with? So this is the place we go. And there is a framework which is available, which says, a kind of a not mandated rules, but it says this is how you can do. And if you think you can adapt something and you can able to modify, you have the freedom to do that. So that is the starting point. And also another thing was like there was a strong commitment from top management to perform all Agile practices. So seriously, the senior management made a decision to move Agile for business reasons, and their commitment is very high. And we have adopted like top-down training model. So since the execs have been participated in creating a backlog, running through the sprint, within sprint, if they don't complete the story, they know what is the pain. Like a CI server is not working. We created a story that they do it in 5 days, but the story might be taken for 4 sprints. They understand what is spillover now. What is the cost of why the velocity is going down. So these things was very well understood by them since they have traveled through the journey, and it helped us. And hired and appointed external coaches. This is very important because in 2014 before we tried Scrum, but whatever it is internally. But once the external coaches are there, they can help the blind spots within our organization structure, and they can able to surface it out much quickly than within our internal things. Emphasis on individuals and interactions through physical Scrum boards. Like individual and interaction versus processes and tools. This is where actually we create the complete physical Scrum boards. Like we ask even directors to walk in rather than asking the status from a tool, so that they come and they witness, they can see the board in the absence of team or the presence of the team. So that tool is there if we have a distributed teams to share it. We use tools, but otherwise predominantly we prefer with physical Scrum boards. Yes.
Question was, did we have co-located teams?
Yes. And we rolled out various guilds, like for product owners, Scrum Master, and team members, where the like-minded people can able to come and they can do innovation. Like we have some problems. Like even they can able to do a creativity, like my retrospectives are getting monotonous. What should I do? They can, like-minded people or whoever is facing the problem, they can form in a guild and they can do for like 2 months, 3 months. And they can find like different techniques. Like out of that, we, with the help of coaches or with us reading several books, we can share the knowledge, and the guilds can give a better outcome. It could be with the process or it could be with the technical. Yeah, over to you, Anil.
Yeah, so this large size, the challenges are not unique. You would have seen it in Dhananjay's earlier presentation. We've added it just to say that we got a feel of our maturity based on the sort of obstacles, challenges that were rising up. So when we started the journey, when the transformation started, we had, as Venkat already showed in a previous slide, lot of traditional designations, and people had to be mapped to the Agile roles. And a test engineer would walk up and say to the manager, will ask, what am I going to be? Am I going to be a developer? Am I going to be a Scrum Master? The role they were going to play, and around that role were the first few problems that people managers had to face, the directors, the senior leadership had to face. They had to explain, they had to educate a lot. And then once the teams were formed and they started playing, you would see that the roles, especially among the first few teams, tend to cross over, and a PO thinking that the Scrum Master is doing his job and the Scrum Master thinking the PO is taking over his job. So a lot of stepping on each other's toes was happening. This sort of, you mature from there, the teams learn the practices and then learn the roles and understand the role, and then they start practicing the ceremonies. And there you start seeing the team struggling to have, to adopt the ceremonies and to stand by the ceremonies. Stand-ups not happening in the 15 minutes, going on and on, you know, people not coming on time for the stand-ups, things like that. So that takes you through the next stage of maturity, and your challenges become sort of competency missing in the team. So you've asked the team to become cross-functional. They were focused on one area. They sort of try to live in that one area. And suddenly they feel that there's nobody to do the UI because they are middleware guys. So this sort of are the issues. And these are the next set of issues that you are going to find because you've asked the team to become cross-functional. And these, up till now, these are the easy issues to find. You, with little or with a systematic investment, you can sort of overcome this this issue. Once you cross this point in your maturity, in your journey, you sort of hit the big problems, right? Your systemic issues, your CI not being able to scale, to be able to make a build in 30 minutes. Okay, you've set out and saying that's my target, but then it takes 4 hours. And then you realize you have to change, you overhaul your whole build system. And your CI not able to run all the test cases in 4 hours because that's the window you have given. And you get only half the test cases done in that 4 hours. And you have an overnight test which sort of breaks halfway through. So you find systemic issues which become obstacles for the team to not perform. And it takes a lot of time to resolve these issues and a lot of investment. And then you reach point where the team now is adopting the processes and wants to do more work, wants to improve its velocity, picks up more stories, and they're not able to complete the stories. And they sort of carry on the spill over the stories and not able to deliver. And that's where, you know, the coaches have helped us a lot, right, in breaking that trend. And those comes with as you mature further, right? And the next set of challenge comes when you find that your team has hit a level of velocity and it's not moving beyond that. And that's where the engineering practices, the new engineering practices that you have to adopt across the organization come into play. So we just put this up. So if you are doing a transformation, for you to get a feel of where you are, the issues that and challenges that pop up sort of give a good indication as to where you are on your journey. With that, I think we'll go on.
Yeah. So, yep.
Any questions?
Yeah, I just had a quick question.
Yep.
Thanks for this presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you. So I was just wondering whether, obviously there's been a very, very huge prioritization by the senior leadership for Agile implementation. Was wondering if you can elaborate more on what were the triggers for that. You did, you know, touch upon the some initial part, right? That
yep.
why it was prioritized, but yep. any particular reason why it was prioritized so high by the senior leadership?
No, it is because right now, as I said, the video market, whatever if you see right now, the competition, whatever it, we are seeing, like say from YouTube or from Apple. So if we, and we are into a traditional, you know, viewing business through setup box, okay? From that perspective, the market is shifting much faster. And if we have to do with the existing way of working, as we see for any new feature, when a customer asks for us, we think 6 months is the development, but they are seeing on the end to end, like you have operational issues. And by the time it launches into the field, it is taking 1.5 years. If we continue to do that, we are the survival is going to get challenged. Maybe not now, immediately. Maybe later of 5 years or 10 years down the line. If you have to make a shift, then you have to do a radical change. And that's what actually one of the trigger where we thought, how can we increase our productivity, okay? And if within the same component structure, and if we do the integration, and if we do in this way, will it work? That is the reason we questioned on from the organization point of view, from the execution point of view, and from the people point of view. So, and that is where in the transformation, we identified all the three areas, and we moved forward.
And just to add to Venkat, one of the key drivers was the business driver there, in that customers wanted us to release faster, okay? We, as Venkat mentioned, we had like a 6 to 12 months, depending upon the complexity of the requirements given by the customer. We took about 6 to 12 months to deliver that feature. And even a critical field issue would take about 3 to 4 weeks to deliver. So we had to break that pattern. We had to figure out a way to deliver faster. Most of the customers who have joined us in our journey have looked at this as a great positive in saying that, yes, we, 2 weeks you are getting a shippable code. We want to be part of that journey where you are releasing things quicker to us. We can influence the journey itself. So they are part of our journey in that they see our backlogs. They prioritize with us the backlogs. So these were some of the key drivers for us to take this transformation.
Hi, My question is, I understood that pay TV must be considering of many projects. And when you guys were transforming from traditional approach to a Scrum, was it a phase movement for some of the projects and the others will follow, or it was, on a one single date, all those projects?
No. That is where I showed you the batches. Like we created, one of the program we call it as evolution. For that, we were around 550 people were there. And we have these many, like 47 customer base was there. So for that, we created batches. And each batch, we slowly started taking whichever the higher priority customers, which we need, which doesn't have an impact on the immediate release plan. So those homeworks were being done, and the batches were being rolled out. So like we started this journey somewhere around like last year, March. And we are right now in the sixth batch, which we just finished the, them onboarding onto the Agile. And we expect that by Q3, we complete all the, batches. So it was like a 1 year course of time, or 1 to 1.5 year, where we onboarded 60 to 70 people, like 4 to 5 backlogs. It may have one feature, one product, and 2 customer projects, something like that. That is how we prioritized based on the, without impacting the existing business and not impacting on the revenue. That is how we have derived the plan. Yeah.
Thank you. How did you eliminate the integration? So, yes, I understand that components needed to be integrated together. Yeah. That's why you had an explicit integration team. But with features also, there needs to be some bit of integration between the features, right? So how did you completely eliminate that?
I'll take it. Yeah. So I'll give you an example of, I was part of wave one, and I handled as a product owner one of our profiles. And the first thing that we did was to make stories vertical stories. So the teams that picked up would deliver everything from the UI all the way down to the functionality. And they were responsible for integrating it and delivering it on the main trunk, right? So earlier what would happen is that you would have a UI team do the UI part. You have a...
I understand that. Yeah. So my point was mostly on the features. So there is a feature one and feature two.
Correct.
These features also need to be integrated, interacting with each other at some point in time. So how were we doing that?
So that's part of your design, right? So when you first you decide a feature which is a vertical feature, you slice it up into stories that are vertical and can be delivered, right, and deliver value. And then as part of your grooming with your leadership, so the leadership has the architect also involved in your team leadership, right? The one of the criteria is to see its interaction with other features. Mm-hmm. And you sort of write your acceptance criteria to cover that interaction.
So it was being handled within the sprints.
It's yes. Yeah.
It's not outside.
It's not outside, outside the sprint.
Okay.
Mic, please.
So, if that particular feature have a dependency on other vertical, like feature delivering in other vertical, then how that is that was handled?
So, we have the CI infrastructure that Venkat mentioned, right? The test cases that go into it essentially are for the main features we have. So, if your team is delivering something. Into the main trunk, there are automated test cases on the CI that we have built, which will test the code for the sanity of the other features. Right? And that particular feature, let me say only one customer has a feature, right? And that platform is added to the CI infrastructure in such a way that when you deliver your feature, or team A delivers it, it doesn't break particular feature which is only available for one customer.
Okay, that is from regression perspective.
Yes. Maybe,
but from the delivery perspective or the development perspective itself, if you have dependency.
May I add?
Go ahead.
Yeah. So here, say for example, before it goes to the Scrum team, the product owner and architect and end-to-end architect, they will groom the feature so granularly that within 2 weeks duration, you can create a vertical slice, which is demoable, like one test scenario of that feature A with all the dependencies identified. The grooming has to be happened first. And in that grooming, all the dependencies will be identified, like how many platforms should I execute. It has relation, you know, it has relation with middleware or UI. What are the dependencies are there? So those dependencies should be identified and see that this backlog and the, like if you have two Scrum teams, three Scrum teams, do they have the competency? And by evaluating that, they create the acceptance criteria in such a way that either I create a stub or a mock so that I can able to fulfill the functionality so that if that is going to take time, that story will come. Like I do a part A of the story. A.1, when they do it, when the component is available, that Scrum team will take the responsibility of removing the stub, integrating it, and doing the regression and performing it. So that whoever the Scrum team takes, they are going to add delta on top of that. So that is how one of the way it can be done.
Thank you.
Yeah.
When you moved from component teams to feature teams, one of the major shifts is multiple feature teams touching the same component,
yes. Which
is entirely different from a set of people touching the same set of components in the earlier days.
Correct.
So this poses a lot of threat towards the architecture being kept intact.
Correct.
So was it a situation for you?
Yeah.
How did you manage, if so?
I think you saw my slides on
the
moderators.
Yeah, I'm just going there only.
On the moderators, you saw it. So that was one of the, in the beginning of our journey, that's one thing we realized, in that we had experts at component level. When we asked the teams to become cross-functional, we still had only experts at the component level, right? So we had a moderator. The first thing we did was to make a guild of moderators. Because from day one, we couldn't have a vertical moderator. So it was almost a guild which each Scrum team would approach and say, I am building this vertical feature. I need a commitment from the guild to review this code and make sure the sanity is there. And over time, a lot of these moderators who are part of that original guild are now vertical moderators. Which means you don't need two or three people reviewing your code, your vertical code. You can now have experts who can, for that feature, be the single point of moderation.
So it's like an open source model where our main trunk is open to all 550 developers who can check in and check out the code. But once they check in, the gatekeeper who is having the component expertise earlier in pockets, since he is either part of the Scrum team or he is part of any one of the Scrum team, so he becomes the gatekeeper for that feature area. Whichever the code comes, he owns that. So he gives his review comments on top of that. Unless until that is not in sync, the developer cannot able to complete the check-in. And here, another way of working is when the developer goes into the sprint planning, if he thinks this is the feature area I'm going to get, because in the look ahead, we submit this, then he calls that moderator into the planning meeting, have a conversation with him when he's bringing the tasks, so that the moderator is involved from the day one before he writes the one line of the code. so that within the sprint duration, it helps him to, because he has already said, this is the approach I'm going to follow, and there is a mutual agreement happened before writing the code, that way what happens is the review becomes faster. So that he doesn't, on the day 5 or day 6 when he submits, the review time is like maybe half an hour or 2 hours, they close the review, so that within the sprint, that story can be delivered.
I had a question on the product owner transformation, right? What is the, how did you approach the overall product owner transformation? Because that's something which I've seen as a challenge in the past. When you move from traditional teams into Scrum, right, product owners being central to the whole Scrum teams and like driving through the velocity of the teams, right? So could you please speak through that?
It's something that we didn't cover here. So I had personally a very interesting journey. I was part of wave one as a product owner. Currently, I am a product manager. With your Scrum Agile, your product owner interaction with the team is quite evident. We have in our organization a separate product management organization. I, as a product manager, interact with product owners. I define the portfolio, take a particular set-top box portfolio. I would define the requirements that the market are demanding. I would write the high-level business epics. Then I sit with the product owner and we detail out the stories, user stories at a high level, that map onto this business epic. We prioritize that. I take back that user stories as what we call the agile commit. And we go in to the approval process saying, this is what, on behalf of the team, the engineering team, I am bringing forward, which is what I, as a product manager and the product owner, have sat together and agreed upon as what is going to go in as the prioritized list for that particular agile commit. So that's the way we work. The tool we are using today for our stories is Riley.
Yeah. I have one question. Yeah. Thanks to both of you for sharing this experience. You have the continuous integration build, and finally when the build is ready, how much time typically do you spend after that? Do you spend any time, first of all, on any of the manual testing, basically? If yes, how much time do you spend?
I'll take that. Right now, as currently our infrastructure, like say for example, the product whatever I'm working has 1,700 test cases, which need to be executed to get the confidence that, okay, it is good to go to deliver and deploy, okay? Now the duration, first thing is we didn't have enough automation infrastructure yet where the 1,700 can be executed, but at least the P1s, whatever are there, so that we wanted to ensure that regression is not in place. So within 4 hours, that execution completes. Beyond that, what we take is we may spend, like in the sprint, that we have a test strategy. How we planned was the CI gives us the baseline every 4 hours. So we take day one's baseline and we do a testing. We know what are the check-ins actually went in. Then day 5, we change the build so that we do only the delta testing. So that what happened is this entire 1,700 test cases are being executed across 10 days from day 1. So that what happens is by day 9 when we come, we know this is the delta which needs to be executed, and we execute that and we deliver it. That is how we have arranged. So you can say the test effort required to execute that 1,700 is spread across, like in the form of 3 or 4 user stories across 10 days.
I have one leading question to this one, maybe last question. Is that, let's suppose, this is more from your more forecasting approach. But let's suppose you are in a situation where you are having every infrastructure, everything ready.
Okay.
Based on your experience, still how much manual testing is required? Your experience.
To me, if you have a robust automation infrastructure, which can give you feedback maybe in one, like when I'm doing a check-in, if I can get 1 hour all the test execution completes, I think you have to do only kind of, if you have any acceptance test which you have agreed with your customer, you should execute it and you should deliver it. That's all. And thanks for Agile India 2015 for giving this platform to us. And thank you all and paying attention to our conversation. And I really enjoyed it. Thank you.